outside of Axtell, Kansas. We may be few in number, but we are here to worship the Lord, praise Him, to listen to His word, and to apply that word to our lives. In the bulletin, you see that there is a council meeting on Tuesday at 7 p.m. Also, in honor of your approaching church anniversary, a recipe book is being put together. And numbers and email addresses to submit recipes to. So we pray that everybody will take part in that, and we'll have a great cookbook when we get done. Are there any other announcements? Thank God for the rain. Although it seems to be a lot all at one time. So, okay. Please stand. The Lord is in His temple. The Lord is in His temple, holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent. Let all the earth keep silent before Him. Keep silence before Him. We read together Psalm 135, 1 through 7. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise Him, you servants of the Lord. You who minister in the house of the Lord, the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing praise to His name, for that is pleasant. For the Lord has chosen Jacob to be His home, Israel to be His treasured possession. I know that the Lord is great, that our Lord is greater than all gods. The Lord who does whatever He pleases in the heavens and on the earth, in the seas and all their depths. He makes clouds rise from the ends of the earth. He sends lightning with the rain and brings out the wind from the storehouses. Let us pray. O Lord, our Maker, Redeemer, and Comforter, we are assembled in your presence to hear your holy word. We pray that you will open our hearts by your Holy Spirit, that through the preaching of your word, we may be taught to repent of our sins, to believe in Jesus, to fight with death, and to grow day by day in grace and holiness. Hear us for Christ's sake. Amen. We sing For the Beauty of the Earth on page 561 in the Lutheran worship.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess
that we are bound to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought or word and deed, by what we have done, by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgave you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Our first reading comes from Isaiah chapter 55, verses 10 to 13. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I propose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Our second reading comes from Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 12. So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, to whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, providing we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for bringing us through another week. Thank you for loving us and caring for us. Thank you for the rain that you sent this morning and for keeping us safe when we passed through high waters and streets that were overflowing with water. Thank you that you see when the crops need rain and when they need sunshine. Lord, we pray that you'll continue to take care of those needs as we go through the coming weeks until harvest. Thank you for taking care of this congregation, for giving them an interim pastor. We pray, Lord, that you continue to guide their search for a pastor, your shepherd, to serve this church, to lead it into new ministries and lead it in growth and in the way that you want it to go. Lord, we pray for those who are suffering from illness. We pray for Stan and Debbie, Rebecca, and her family. Denny, Jim, Bob, Vitosky, Kay, and all others that we lift up in our hearts before you now. Thank you that you hear our prayers. You know the burdens that are on our hearts, whether they're personal or for friends, burdens for family, for financial needs, relationship needs. Lord, we just lift all these things up to you and know that even before we ask, you have started sending the answer to those prayers and are guiding us as we work out our lives, as you work in our lives, to bring the answers that you desire. All these things we ask for in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. The great crowds gathered about him, so that he got into the boat and sat down. The whole crowd stood on the beach, and he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on the rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil, but when the sun rose, they were scorched. And since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. Jesus said to the disciples, hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the devil, the evil one, comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what is sown along the path. As for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. And when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches chokes the word, and it proves unfruitful. As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands. He indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and another 50. The Gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. I'm sure you've all heard sermons about this parable before. Some scholars like to make God the sower of the word. Others say that we are the sower of the word. But whether it's God or us sowing the word, the seed is still the word of the kingdom. It's still the gospel that goes out. Now, we may have some difficulties with some of these concepts. You know, modern farmers, now there's great big planters. Most likely this farmer he was talking about was sowing wheat or barley. Nowadays, these big tractors pull machines behind them that drill the seed right into the ground so they don't have to worry about the hard path, or they don't have to worry about the rocky soil. And then we put herbicides on so we don't have to worry about the weeds coming up beside it. But in Jesus' day, the sower would scatter the seed like this. He'd fan it out, and so the seed did fall on the path, on the rocky ground, among the thorns, and some on the good soil. Jesus makes it pretty clear what each one of these soils is like. This morning, though, I would like to look at this parable in light of our Isaiah passage. Isaiah 55, verse 11 says, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but shall accomplish that which I propose, and shall succeed in the things for which I sent it. But why does God send his word out to these various, what we would call, bad soils, rather than using modern techniques and making it all fall on the good soil? Well, in the telling of the parable, the seed that fell on the path, we have one answer in the telling of the parable. The seed was sown so that the birds ate it. We read in the Sermon on the Mount that God takes care of the sparrow. So, you know, this is one way that he takes care of the sparrow. But the sparrows don't eat the gospel. So we have to look at something else. In his explanation, Jesus says that the birds are the evil one that comes and snatches the word away before it has a chance to get implanted on this hard ground. Hard ground is a hard heart. Some places in the Old Testament we read about either a hard heart or how God hardened a person's heart so that they weren't able to, not only not able to receive the word, but also not able to have a relationship with God. So, what is accomplished by God allowing the word to fall on hard hearts? What I don't have perfect answers for all for these questions, but one reason could be, as the seed falls the first time, it makes a little bit of an indent, so that next time when the seed falls on that hard heart, the Holy Spirit has already made a little bit of a dent. Maybe the hard path has become dry and there are, like we saw a few weeks ago, cracks in the soil. And the seed may have a chance to get down into those cracks. Another reason that God may allow, the purpose for which God sends the gospel to the hard heart, is so that we can see, we Christians can see, how hard the world can be. That not everybody loves God the way we do. And that not everybody is going to accept the gospel. The second soil was the rocky soil, rocky places. And this reminded me of Flash in the Pan Christians. It says it grew up quickly, it had no roots, so when troubles and problems came along, it withered. We have seen this with some revival movements, or people were concerned about this when, like, Billy Graham would have a crusade, or kids would go to Christian concerts. Everybody, when they leave, is really excited about the experience they had with God. And the experience, especially the emotional experience that I've had in that situation. But when they get home, they start being persecuted and say, oh, he gave himself to Christ, that thing. That can't mean anything. I don't see a change in his life. Troubles and difficulties start arising. And we know that Jesus promised that we would have troubles in this life. So that is part of the reason that God may use this to show us that we do need to have, like the Billy Graham organization does, when there is a revival, we need to have the churches ready to take these people in and feed them. Bible study and worship and make sure that their roots do go deep rather than just being in rocky ground and their Christian life withering as soon as it's grown up. It also could be part of God's purpose in allowing it to fall on the rocky ground as a warning to us that we don't need to let those rocks, we don't need to let the seeds in our lives be on rocky ground. And we need to stay in the Word and stay in the good soil rather than getting into the rocky ground and letting, it's so easy to start letting worries and troubles take away our joy of studying the Word and our joy of having a relationship with Christ. The third ground was the thorns. The wheat or barley grew up along with the thorns. Speaking, Lord. Grew up with the thorns and the worries of the world and seeing everybody else around them being wealthy and choked out the life that was given to the person in Christ. This seed, this plant, wasn't killed, but it didn't bear fruit either. And this may be what is present in a lot of our churches today. People who have an experience with Christ, they sometimes read the Word, have a little bit of soil, have a little bit of depth, but they worry about everything. They aren't able to trust God to take care of them in good and bad situations. Or they look at the world and see, oh, my friends are successful. They're earning a lot of money. They're climbing the corporate ladder. Or that guy's farm seems to be doing a whole lot better than mine is. And he's able to build a new house and have a new shed and have a new tractor or combine every 2 or 3 years. I want that. And those thorns get into our lives and snatch away the joy and the excitement and the relationship that we have with Christ. What's God's purpose in sowing seed among the thorns? It shows us what could happen to us if we aren't on our guard. Weeds and thorns can grow up in our lives, and our eyes can be taken off of Jesus and onto the things of the world. If I were God, I would use the modern things and drill those seeds right down into the ground so that 100% of those seeds went into good soil. But God uses the Word going out to hard-hearted people, people who have shallow Christian lives, and people who have their eyes turned away from the Lord, to show us as warning signs for us of what can happen to us. Also, it helps us to be able to talk to those that are among the thorns and on the rocky path and on the hard path that they do need to change. They need to come and have a deeper relationship with God. And it also leads us to pray for the various people that we see, that our eyes will be open to see people that are in these various situations, so that the Lord can work to move them, transplant them from the path, from the rocky area, from the thorns, to the good land, good soil. I think it's God's desire that all of his word be planted in good soil, but he allows the other for our growth too. I encourage you to be planted in good soil and to put your roots down deep into the good soil so that your life will produce fruit. In some cases, 100-fold, in some places, 60, and in some cases, 30-fold. We don't always realize how much fruit we are producing or where the fruit is that is being produced for our lives. We need to be fruitful, faithful to grow and produce the fruit that God has given us to produce, and not to worry about everybody else and what they're doing. So I encourage you this week, spend time in the Word, spend time in prayer, put your roots down deep, increase your relationship, just like we sang, what a friend I have in Jesus. He takes care of all of our worries and woes. He takes care of all of our needs so that we don't have to look after the wealthy and be envious of them. He takes care of when our heart is hard in a certain area, in an area that he wants to change, and convict us that we aren't doing exactly what he wants us to do in that area. The Holy Spirit, you will allow him, will help you to produce fruit 100, 60, and 30-fold. And Lord bless, give his blessing to the hearing of his word. We sing, He Leadeth Me, O Blessed God.
Thank you.
please stand. We continue with communion service on page 88 in the green book. Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father. Through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The feast is ready. I invite all who believe that Jesus comes to us in a special way to come forward and partake. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ to strengthen you and renew you until his coming. blood of Christ sheds for your sins. Take and drink. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you of his coming. Go in peace. Read together on page 92, the Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord and sing his praise. Tell everyone what he has done. Let everyone who seeks the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He recalls his promises and leads his people forth in joy. With shouts of thanksgiving, alleluia, alleluia. Let us pray. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one comely food, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.